Mick Quinn. I joined the army at 17 in 1981 and served for 21 years, discharging in 2002. Over that time, I served in the Royal Corps of Signals and I achieved the rank of Warrant Officer Class 1 before discharge. I suppose the highlight of my service was warlike service serving in Cambodia on a peacekeeping mission there to bring fair and free elections to the country. Over my career, I served in many different roles, that of a basic radio operator, cipher operator, keyboard operator, over to management roles, career manager, trade manager. And I discharged at the age of 38, feeling like I was getting a little bit too old for the system and a little bit worn out from the system itself. I left the army and started up my own business in minor works and constructions and subcontracting off builders. Did this for a number of years. My body was fairly worn before I started into that game, and I had to do a fairly significant switch, and I became a professional advocate looking after veterans, representing them for all levels of application through to the courts to get fair and equitable compensation. I was medically retired out of the workforce a number of years ago now, probably about 4 or 5, and took on this role as a volunteer, and also over this period of time took on the role of a veteran lobbyist to look after veterans' entitlements and to bring the Department of Veteran Affairs back into a focus where they were putting the veterans first and looking after their well-being. Highlight of my career, as I said, was working in Cambodia. I deployed there when I was around about 27 years of age. I worked with the Khmer Rouge while I was there. That was the detachment I was put with. The achievement and the good side of this is what we can look back on, a country developing through to where it is today, where the poverty is starting to lift, the country is moving forward, the casualties by victims of war has severely reduced now, and the country is moving forward. The friends and so forth over this time, which we have dealt with, have been affected in many different ways. Exposure by anyone to a third world country, poverty, and the death and carnage is a big impact and an eye-opener to everyone. Living in those environments with the added stresses of the danger changes people for life, sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worse. I'm very, very passionate on making sure that all those who served and all those who experiences the not only the rigours of service life but also deployment, they're also looked after. Our men and women that join the Army, Navy or Air Force are quite young when they join, between the ages of 17 and 20 on average. At the age of 17 or 20, if you look at your own children and look back and think of their experiences over life, a lot of them haven't even experienced death of a friend, death of a mother or father, or birth of a child, and all of those things which grow us in mental strength over time. What they do have, which the in that particular group, is a hell of a lot of enthusiasm, the want of excitement, and very much drawn to defence to get that, and they do get that. Over the time in defence, these same men and women who were very young, without the life experiences which can prepare you for a lot of different things, are deployed to the most difficult of places and dealing with the most difficult of situations, and also some of the most dangerous which we would see any Australian put in. When you look at the build-up of this from a psychological profile, you can understand that there will be massive issues on resettlement back to civilian life. They've gone into effectively what's an institution prior to learning how to use banking properly, learning about loans, learning about family, coping with death, and all those other issues which we build up over time. And we grow stronger for all those experiences. With the young men and women of defence, a lot of them are stepping out without those experiences and are basically hitting the street
with experiences past what any Australian has ever achieved, or ever want to achieve, I guess, in a lot of respects, to be able to cope in a civilian world where they have to grow, fit in, change their manner in which they work in the workforce, expectations and so on. It's a real consideration we have to put to our youth of Australia when they're going into the system, that the older in the system look after the younger and try to pass on and expose the younger members to those experiences of life. But more so, when they leave the military, we need to have in place systems that actually breach that gap so that their experiences are those that make them stronger and better in the community, because they more than have the capability of doing so. Yeah, veteran suicide has become a very big and noticeable problem as well. Veteran numbers post-Vietnam are starting to build up. In the early 90s, the problem was quite small. And when I say quite small, we had deployments of 400 over to Sinai, then we had 1,200 over to Cambodia. Lost a few friends over the way who decided to take their own life. After Timor, Afghanistan and Iraq, these numbers started to drastically grow to the point they were having a massive impact on the veteran community, and there was very few veterans that hadn't experienced losing one of their mates to suicide. We've been looking at a heap of the causal issues, and there's a number of groups which are monitoring what's happening, and one particular group, Warriors Return, which is actually recording the numbers. In 2017, we had 87 suicides, and was probably the worst year we've had since we started deploying in the early 90s. A number of initiatives have popped out, and more verbally, we've been targeting the Department of Veteran Affairs to tidy up its act in the dealing with veterans. Not blaming them entirely for the problem, but they're just one of the possible causal links. Other causal links which exist to it is that with mental health affecting families, mental health impacting on the individual where they can't see another or better way out, the ability to actually stand up and say, my mind's in such a state that I want to take my own life. We've been running campaigns for mates to listen to mates to make themselves available to other friends, so that they've got someone to call when that moment hits, where they're actually sitting in a bottom pit, and they just need to chat for a while until that feeling passes and they can get a more of a positive focus. The big thing which we want to make sure of is not one more veteran takes his or her life again because of their service.